All right, today is February 6th, and this is 2024, and this is our operator framework upstream working group meeting. I've got the agenda up here, and it looks like we're pretty light today. I'm going to copy and paste this up to here for this brief. But we've got one of our briefs that has a lazy consensus day of today. I haven't seen any updates on this in a while, so I assume we're pretty good to go here. For those not familiar, this brief is about essentially helping clients understand what updates are available in the catalog for their operators that are installed. We're going to experiment a lot with this one, so I don't think it's too important to have a really perfectly crisp design here. A lot of this, I think, is going to be try something out, iterate, get feedback, and try again if necessary. So if anyone's interested, take a look. But I don't think it's a huge thing if we don't have every I dotted and T crossed. No action items, it doesn't look like. Does anyone else know of anything that they want to bring up in terms of past meeting action items or anything that, you know, is related to that? All right, sounds good. Looks like Anik added a discussion topic here. He can't attend, but essentially proposing that we start talking about what metrics we want to include in OLMV1 beyond just what's standard in the controller runtime metrics. Looks like we don't have anything planned for it in iteration 3 or iteration 4, but something we'll want to do before GA. So if anyone has any thoughts or ideas here, or questions or comments, we can talk about it. I'm sure I can have my own opinions too.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the metrics will be important in the long run. So I think it doesn't hurt to start the conversation on that. But I think iteration 3 and 4 is focused on like a pretty big shift underneath from switching from RuckPack to cap controller. So I think a lot of the metrics that we're probably going to be looking at are probably somewhere tied around that kind of like needing to come after that work. So definitely open to having that discussion, but I don't have any thoughts on it at the moment.
Yeah, I think I'm of the same mind as you. Like in my head, we probably just want to admit some metrics about what APIs are being used. And until we have the right footprint of what those APIs look like, there's probably not a lot here. I do think it's probably reasonable for us to at least create an issue on the backlog, and then we can prioritize that in a future iteration.
Thanks, Kevin. I agree. I and Bryce, I think we should try to keep it super scoped since we already have other things that we're trying to do that are going to matter for this. So what if we said that go ahead and create an issue and just scope it to metrics that are essentially like yes or no or counts of these APIs are, you know, have objects or not. That should be fairly straightforward and something that we could sort of get in during one of these iterations. And then that gives us a little bit of information, you know, if we ever, you know, have telemetry or anything, or and helps users understand if they're installing OLM on their cluster and they want to understand how their users are using it, they can get a decent idea just based on that.
Yep. Yeah, that makes sense to me. I can go ahead and create an issue.
Cool. Let me Thanks, Kevin. All right. That is it for discussion topics that are on the agenda. Does anyone else have anything to bring up?
Hey Joe, this is Yanni. I do have maybe two questions. First of all, the OCP 4.14 is coming out. Do we have any change or update to the Olam V1 in the tech preview in this upcoming release?
I'm not sure if this is the exact right call to talk about that, since this is
Oh,
upstream.
sorry. If it's not, okay.
We can certainly take that offline and talk about it for sure, though.
Okay.
Sorry
And
about that.
No problem. The second question is, I saw that we have quite a lot of discussion in this issue 269. I can paste the link here in the chat about the multi-tenant clusters considerations. A lot of discussions between my team and CloudPack teams and OLMs. So I'm wondering, are you planning to update any doc to reflect the new design? I can see there are a lot of changes and good discussion about separating the APIs and controllers and also about how to handle like dependency resolutions. A lot of stuff in this issue. So I'm wondering if you're planning to update any document to reflect what would be the new design.
Yeah, I think we're planning to do that essentially as we're also developing this stuff. I think there's still some details to work through on the specifics of some of the ways that multi-tenancy would work. But for the most part, I think we've landed pretty well on the high level, you know, let's have a namespace scoped extension API, and then have separate, you know, essentially like suggest separate bundles for APIs and controllers. I think that'll take us pretty far. I don't think there's anything in any of the upstream milestones to actually go and do documentation about this. Let's see. And I don't see anyone that usually works on documentation, but I think we can take that back and figure out, you know, what we want to do about that. Certainly we'd be willing to accept pull requests if anyone is interested in trying to document where we are. Separately, there is something that we're working on, just writing a document that sort of explains where we are right now. So, you know, as a lot of you guys know, we've been spending, you know, it's, when did we open this issue, right? It's been what, 7-8 months about this. We've been talking about it and iterating and iterating and trying to come up with a design. I think where we are now is probably a reasonable spot to say, okay, now's the right time to write down sort of where we are and how we arrived. So, that's also ongoing right now. I'm working on that and making sure that it's ready to be posted. We'll make a pull request that puts it directly into the repo. So I would expect that within the next couple of weeks. Bryce, I see your hands up.
Yeah, I was going to say, with respect to multi-tenancy specifically, and feel free to correct me if I'm wrong in my understanding on this, but my understanding is that Olam V1 isn't going to have like explicit multi-tenancy support, but it's the architecture that we're going for of having the namespace scoped extensions and, you know, suggesting API and controller separated bundles. All that stuff is like leaving room for somebody to architect something to do with multi-tenancy, but we're not going to explicitly say that Olam V1 has multi-tenant capabilities and pushing that out there, right?
I think that's right. Yeah. I mean, that's, as Andy and I tried to look at this and a lot of other people contributed over the last year, basically, we just can't find a solution that is something that core Olam can support that makes multi-tenancy a first-class thing. But we recognize that there's lots of use cases for, you know, different reasons to have multi-tenant style deployments. And so we're going to try to come up with sort of the minimal thing that we can support that could support multi-tenancy on top. So essentially, I think what that means is, and again, this is sort of in the doc that I'm trying to write, but what I think that boils down to is namespace scoped APIs, no first class support for like setting watch namespaces or anything that will like dictate different scopes. And then therefore like that sort of everything falls out from that. So because we don't like, because OLM doesn't know which namespaces are being watched, then that also means that it's not able to do dependency resolution based on which controllers are watching which namespaces. So there's a few things that we're still trying to come up with like the right way to document what's going to be supported in core OLM and what we would expect, you know, multi-tenant cluster admin style deployment use cases to need to do on top. So still more to come there. So one of the things that we're looking at, like for, I just put a comment actually on one of our issues, but one of the things that we're looking at is like, well, we can still allow an admin to specify parameters and values for a bundle. And if the bundle says it supports a parameter called watch namespaces, then OLM will happily pass that parameter along to the bundle. And for registry V1 bundles, all of them support watch namespaces because they all have install modes, and we can essentially like write a YTT template that makes that possible. So like everything that you can do in OLM V0 is possible, or in theory will be possible in OLM V1, but like the core controllers won't know about those values is what we're thinking. So yeah, we need to write it all down and get a PR up, and we can have comment on that. So yeah, hopefully in the next week or two.
Okay, that sounds great. I also see the discussion about the RBAC, and it looks like in OLM V1, we are not going to have the admin, the cluster admin privilege for the OLM. So that means the user need to create a service account, which would include the permissions to deploy the operator as an extension. And I also remember in maybe one of the discussions, it was mentioned that there may be some kind of tool or utility to help with that. And also at one point there was a discussion about the permission request, some kind of workflow to go through the permission request. So I'm not sure in this space, do we settle down on going which path? It sounds like there are a lot of discussion in this space. I'm not sure if we have settled down what is the final decision regarding supporting the deployment, as OLM will not have the privilege by default to deploy those things.
Yeah, I think the plan that we're going with right now is that we're going to create a new extension API that Todd has a PR up for right now. I'm not sure if Todd has it in the PR. Todd, you can chime in if you want to talk about it, but essentially we'll put a service account field on the extension spec, and OLM will essentially like get a token for that service account. It'll have permission to create tokens for service accounts, and then it'll use that token to authenticate and perform whatever actions are necessary for that extension using that service account. Essentially what that means is that when it's on the extension, we'll go and create a Carvel app CR, and then Carvel is actually what does it. So that is sort of the basis for the plan right now. We've decided to forego the permission request API since it just adds another layer of complexity. But instead, what we're talking about is, like you said, like, is there a tool that could be written? And the answer is yes, probably. I've got a little prototype that I'm working on actually right now that is like a kubectl plugin that it's sort of like kubectl apply -f whatever, except rather than apply, it's like make RBAC for these manifests. And it goes and inspects everything and tries to come up with the right set of RBAC in a service account, essentially with all the right role bindings and roles and cluster role bindings and cluster roles that service account would need to be able to manage the installation for whatever the bundle is. And then in theory, a cluster admin could run this tool, pipe it to kubectl create, and then boom, like you've got a service account in the right place where you can go and create an extension and have it use that service account. So in theory, automation could be built on top of this, right? Like core OLM is going to say, hand us a service account and we'll use it. Mm-hmm. But if there's other tooling that exists in the ecosystem, then it's certainly possible that if you wanted a more automated experience, you could write a controller that essentially like inspects the bundle. And this is where like we have to continue talking about this, but something that could inspect the bundle and do this same sort of like, well, make the RBAC that I would need. And then that tool would have, you know, essentially cluster admin permission and could go and stamp out all of the RBAC that would be necessary to create it all and bind it to a service account and set it free essentially. So I think the long story short here is OLM core, we're going to sort of keep it pretty simple, at least initially. Secure by default still as much as we can. And it still leaves room for tools being built on top that do different types of automation based on what the need is.
Okay, thank you.
And just to kind of add on top of that as well, as part of the OLM secure by default stuff, using cap controller, there's also an issue, and I've started working on it in cap, and then I would need to kind of go to cap controller as well before it's in place. But they currently like will create manifests up until they can't and don't validate like the permissions of the service account before attempting to apply the manifests. So that could leave you in kind of like a half state if like you have half the permissions and you don't have the other half. So I'm working on creating a change and pushing it up to cap that there's going to be like a flag that we can validate the permissions before applying any of the manifests. And so it's in a similar vein to the tool Joe was working on. And I think that we could, you know, with cap controller, we could probably make a pull request that information bubbles up through the status and we can bubble that up, you know, through the extension status or something like that, that gives a nice user experience to see like what exactly are the permissions that are missing to, you know, create, to actually install the operator. And maybe like Joe said, you could build a tool on top of that where we look at that particular status condition and see all the missing permissions or whatever, and then something can be generated. So just wanted to throw that on for a little additional insight.
Thank you, Bryce. You mentioned the cap controller. Is that another open source or is it part of the OLM V1?
Yeah, so cap controller is what we're replacing RuckTac with in the underlying OLM V1 components. And that is a component of Carvel. And so there's, if you look up carvel.dev, I think is their doc site, you can see all the projects that they have, but it's also, it's a Kubernetes package manager, but it's, as far as I'm aware, it's not tailored specifically towards things like operators or what have you, and it's kind of like a more generic thing, but I think Joe or Varsha, if either of you have more insight on that, definitely feel free to correct me on that.
Sorry, I was typing and missed that, Bryce.
I was just saying that cap controller is part of Carvel, which is also a package manager, but it's more, as far as I understand it, it's more generic in the packages rather than OLM is going to be more tailored towards, you know, cluster extension or like extensions or what have you, operators, yeah, stuff like that. But so we're bringing Cap Controller in to replace Ruckpack and build on top of that for like how things are deployed.
The whole Carvel tool suite is tries to solve many of the same problems, right? It's like there's a repository of packages, there's this package install API that's similar to our extension API. Both of those would be namespace scoped. I think the major differences are that the like we're more operator focused still, so there's going to be some extra features and support for CRDs, looking at them and doing validation, at least best effort to tell you, hey, this is something that might cause problems with your cluster if you upgrade. And then other things around sort of the traditional OLM upgrade path, help and dependency management and stuff that Carvel doesn't have right now. So I would say they're very similar, but there are certain features that we want to make sure are in our project that Carvel doesn't have, primarily around you know, specific operator style concerns. Okay, anything else that anyone would like to bring up?
So the only thing I have was the, I mentioned the extension API PR up there. So any comments, feedback would be appreciated.
Sounds good, thanks Todd. Yeah, that's the first step. So there's a few steps that we're working. Maybe this is the right time. I know we talked about this a little bit last week, but we've gone and added a bit more detail here. So we've got a few, let's see, where are we, roadmap. So I think we pretty much have the same list of epics here. So we're gonna add this extension API. That's basically what Todd's working on. Separately, we're trying to switch Ruckpack out and add Cap Controller. So these two are sort of the first steps. Once we do that, then we can start going into some of the more interesting, well, these are pretty interesting, I guess, but like that's sort of the basis for what all of these APIs that you were sort of asking about, Yanni. Those are sort of the basis for what the architecture is going to look like. And then we get into more discussion about what different nuances of that we can implement. So yeah, I guess my point here is, the sooner we can get some reviews and get moving on the extension API, the sooner we can start going further down that path.
Yeah, definitely would like to review once it's ready.
The one thing I added here, since I've got folks, is that I put a comment on this story. So this says add watch namespaces to extension spec. This was, I think, sort of the one contention point that we had in terms of like how far are we going to support multi-tenancy or not. And I think right now, my opinion is that we should not explicitly support a first-class watch namespaces field on the spec that this issue sort of alludes to. So rather, what I think we should do is do something that's very similar to what Carvel does, which is expose a spec.values field on our extension, which OLM doesn't control the schema of. In Carvel, the package gets to define what the schema is for a particular for its bundle. So I think we should do something similar in the extension API, where we expose a values field for registry V1 bundles, which is all we pretty much have at this point. We're going to control the YTT template, so we know exactly what schema we can support in this field, which means we can go ahead and add a watch namespaces value to that schema and then have it exposed that way. So this is, in my mind, something that keeps OLMV1 out of the multi-tenancy first-class support zone, but also makes it still possible. So I'm curious if folks have any thoughts on this comment, or, you know, yeah, it looks like Marsha, you've got your hand up. And I can't hear you. I see you're unmuted, Varsha, but we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I agree with this. It would be a more cleaner way of explicitly bridging what an operator author wants and what a user wants to install. The only additional work I see here, which probably we eventually have to do it anyway, is to allow templating while creating an operator bundle itself. So probably these template values need to be injected when a bundle is created, so that an operator author can basically specify what are the values that can be modified by the user, similar to how the package API does.
Yeah, I think that is absolutely what we would want to do long term. And maybe we would want to split this out. In my mind, if we're only concerned about registry v1 bundles, we pretty much know in advance, because we control the YTT template, exactly which fields we're going to support having template values for. So what I would probably say is, let's figure out, like, if you look at the OLMV0 subscription.spec.config field, it might be possible for us to essentially support everything that's in the subscription.spec.config field and also the watch namespaces for every single registry v1 bundle, and put that sort of in this opaque spec.values field, potentially, like, even define a schema for it so that we can do validation on it. But, like, we essentially will know when we're looking at the catalog, oh, this is a registry v1 bundle. So therefore, like, we know exactly what the schema is. So we can go and run the validation on the extensions spec.values. And if, you know, if we picked something that's going to violate what is specified on that spec.values field, then we can report a status that says, like, no can do. Later then, when we want to support something other than registry v1 bundles, I would agree, like, we'll want to have something in the catalog that tells us what that schema is. But I don't think we need that initially, because I think we know what the schema is for every single registry v1 bundle. Is that, do you agree with that?
Yep. Yep. I think, Joe, if I'm understanding right, the idea is to introduce template, or I don't know, a values field in the cluster, sorry, not the cluster extension, the extension API itself, right? So that basically the user, I think one another advantage of this is we would inherently also support Helm values to be injected. I don't think Rugpack does that right now, but if we expose that similar to package install, that's something which we would get just by doing it.
Yep. So I went ahead and changed the title here, and I will modify this to say in scope. Something like that.
What else does subscription.spec.config take in apart from the watch namespaces?
So subscription spec config does not have watch namespaces in it, because that's sort of separately implicit based on where the subscription is and what the install group says. What subscription.spec.config contains is stuff like node affinity and node selectors and annotations and labels and, like, other things that you might want to inject into. I think it's pretty much limited to, like, the deployment for the controller, or, you know, whatever the deployment specified in the CSV is. But either way, I think the point is, like, there's a bunch of fields there that OLM has very specific logic about how to translate and merge into the final manifests that aren't all that different than some of the logic that OLMV has for, like, generating RBAC. So I think we could probably, I think we could expand that YTT template that you worked on to include support for this if the values are provided.
Yeah, that's doable, definitely.
And I think we could totally split this even further, right? Like, if we only did watch namespaces and registry V1 bundles, that would be a great start. So maybe I'll say this is stretch. And then if we decide that it's a little bit more difficult, we can always split that out into a separate issue. Okay. I think that wraps us up. Oh, Yanni, you've got a hand up.
Yeah, Joe, I just have a question about this watch namespaces. Maybe I didn't understand it right. I know in OLMV 0, we have this operator namespace and then the target namespaces. But I don't remember we have the watch namespaces. So maybe it's trying to do something differently from OLMV 0. And we also have the multiple deployment mode, right? You can deploy to single namespace, multiple namespaces, and all namespaces. So is this watch namespaces kind of trying to do what OLMV1, V0 is trying to do, is doing today, or it's...
Yeah, I think the goal here is, there's sort of two sort of opposing goals, but... In OLMV 0, there's an operator group that defines for every single subscription in CSV that end up in a namespace. That will be the watch namespaces that OLM injects into all of those controllers. So as an admin, you would go and create an operator group and say, you know, my target namespaces are foo and bar. And then anytime that you create a subscription in that namespace, then OLM is going to set an annotation that says OLM.target namespaces for this controller is foo and bar. And then the expectation then is that those controllers know about that annotation and process it and make sure they set up their informers to only watch foo and bar. In OLMV1, there is no operator group API. Instead, every single extension is going to be able to say, here's my configuration. And this is where it gets into a little bit of opposing goals. Because of the problems with trying to have a first-class support for multi-tenancy, we're not going to have like a first-class API for setting target namespaces like we did in OLMV 0. So instead, this issue is essentially about like, well, we should still be able to configure it. Like if I'm a cluster admin and there's a controller bundle that exposes a schema for its values that has a watch namespaces field, I as a cluster admin should be able to specify the watch namespaces for that bundle. So that's what this issue is about. And for registry V1 bundles, well, we know that they all support this watch namespaces concept because they have an install modes field in their CSV. And so I think what we're going to try to do here is say, okay, well, when we see that it's a registry V1 bundle, we know what the schema is going to be for its values. It's going to essentially be like this, a combination of watch namespaces and what's in the subscription.spec.config. And then when we go and create an app CR for it, we know exactly how to translate a registry V1 bundle into the underlying objects that are going to be applied to a cluster. So we'll go ahead and look at what values were provided for watch namespaces and essentially this subscription.spec.config equivalent. And while we're processing that YTT template, we'll make sure that we create whatever RBAC and inject whatever olm.target namespaces values are appropriate for that extension. So I think like the outcome here is going to be registry V1 bundles all have the exact same value schema. And if you're using registry V1 bundles only, then you can expect that there'll be this same schema and you can always apply values in the same way, and essentially implement the same sort of multi-install for the same controller behavior that Olim v0 gives you. But Olim v1 is not going to be like at the extension layer. Olim v1 is not really aware of anything that's in this values field. In theory, this is sort of opaque values, sort of agreed upon between the bundle and the cluster admin via the schema idea. And all Olim v1 is going to do is say, like, okay, I'll take those values that provided me, bang them against the schema. If those work, then I'll just pass it on down to the app template and let it handle it and do its thing. So Olim v1 is not going to be able to build any further logic on top of the contents of what's in those values, if that makes sense.
Okay.
All right. If that is it, anybody else have any comments, questions, discussions? Otherwise, I think we've pretty much reached the end of the agenda. All right. Thanks, folks. We'll see you next week.
Thanks, Joe.
Thank you.